So first of all, I'm very happy to be here this morning and be able to talk to you once again about the work that we did in Quebec for 4 years. I have to say that from the get-go that for me, having worked on that topic for a long period of time, I think that the only difference between Quebec and the rest of Canada is now that we know about the problems that we have. So, and that's giving us say an advance now because we can start working on it. And the best way to, it's not if corruption exists or not, the question, it's there. It's just that when you know about it, you can start finding solution and that's where you get you advance. Because you know, as citizens, just citizens, we all have the same concern regarding our public institution and politicians. We want to have to be able to trust them, and it's often a trust issue. We have to want to be able to trust that they are working in the best interest of a society. And we want to make sure that they are shielded from undue influence of all sorts. And it is essential to keep working towards that goal. And every time I have the opportunity to speak, all I say is that you have to keep the conversation going, because the moment you think that you're done, or the moment you look away, that's the moment it all starts all over again and it gains ground. So it's not, I'm not making it like a pessimist story, but it's just like when we talk about it like we do today, it's the way to keep it alive and to be aware. And that's what we did for 4 years, very painfully, very publicly. We exposed our situation and ourselves, I would say, to the world now. But we gained a lot by doing this. And we did that for 4 years with the Commission Charbonneau. And like you're doing today, we also had to learn from other experiences, and we had to look elsewhere for answers and ways to analyze these situations. We had an extensive research department at the Commission Charbonneau. I would say that at the height of the commission, 125 persons were working on that topic with us. Us, the persons, the prosecutors and the commissioners who were public, was like, we were just like the tip of the iceberg. There was a full body of investigators, analysts, experts and researchers working to help us move towards that, move through that mandate. And we had to gather information and opinions from other public inquiries as well on similar subjects that we were facing, and that helped us forge a understanding of the situations that we analyzed and we came about, and maybe find solutions. Are they the best solutions? We'll see over time, but that's what we thought that we should move towards. And that is why I really welcome the initiative of British Columbia and David to start, who started all that, to have the report translated, because I am happy that our work can help others and transcend Quebec's frontiers. Just to give you a little bit of background before we Natalie and I start chatting, because I'm talking about discussion and I think that's the best way to go around and give information, it's talking about it, so we'll try to do it like that. Just let me give you a little bit of background. In October 19 of October 2011, the government of Quebec decided to create the public inquiry, but it was all done after extensive media work and pressure that they were uncovering what appeared to be scandal after scandals, and the pressure kept building up in the media and the public awareness, if I could say it like that, for a couple of years before the government finally gave in and created the public inquiry on the subject. And we can understand that because the politicians have to create the inquiry and they are at the center of it all when we start talking about it. So we understand like the resistance, but public pressure, media pressure, stories getting out there on a daily basis, scandals involving ministers and electives going on boats to major contractors and giving them big chunks of our public money after that. That's what created the buzz and I would say pushed them towards creating the commission. It was then giving a very extensive mandate. We now say 4 years afterwards, like too large of a mandate. It was an impossible task to cover everything for us, but still we managed, I think, to find our way in all that. We had, first of all, examine the existence of schemes involving collusion and corruption in the awarding of public construction contract. We were limited to the construction industry because at the time in Quebec, all the stories that were going around in the media were about the construction industry, and it's a bit logical because it's a big chunk of all the public money is going towards roads and construction, so it was a very fertile ground to explore. And we had to look at the possibility of links to political party financing in the awarding process. It was very marginal, and we had to treat it as marginal because we had, like I said, too many places to look, too many things to uncover, but we had also to look into the possibility of organized crime infiltrating the same industry. And of course, the main purpose of the commission was to make recommendations. Even if people think that it was reality show 4 years, the purpose of the commission was to write a report and make recommendations. So over the course of the 4 years, we heard over 300 witnesses. Those are the ones we heard publicly, but we met over 2,000 persons, I would say, just to gather information, get knowledge, and understand what we were dealing with. But we presented in evidence 300 witnesses and more than 3,600 documents. It's all available for anybody to read, to look at, and to study if you need to. Like I said, exposing this situation was not an easy task. It was hard, it was painful, it went on for 4 years. We got awarded the most corrupt province in Canada, I would say, but it's just because that we exposed it and we worked at it and we looked at it. I mean, it's not because it does not exist anywhere. And one of the questions that I'm going to go ahead that Natalie wanted to ask me is what happened that we didn't expect. Even with all the stories that were going around in the media, it was the tip of the iceberg. When we started digging, and I was telling David this morning, it's like when you are in your bathroom and you see a water stain. Okay, it's just a small water stain, and then you open up the wall, and then you dig, and then you find all the rot. What's going on in the public, in the media, was just a water stain, and we thought it was a big water stain, but I mean, the house, and what we uncovered when we started digging, and it's the same everywhere. How did they say it? There's no smoke without a fire, or something like that. It's the same everywhere. So, I have to emphasize on the fact that I am not an expert in collusion and I'm not an expert in corruption. I was just a privy observer for 4 years. I heard a lot of stories, I saw a lot of stories, I read a lot of stuff, so I may be more in tune on what's going on, but I am not an expert and I want to emphasize that. So, but I want to share my experience as much as I can, and I have insights because I've been bathing in that for 4 years, so that's why I'm here today and I'm proud. But the report says it all, and I really, really encourage you, if you're interested in remotely, to read it because it's full of information and you will be amazed. So what I'm going to do right now is just maybe give you a few highlights, because the goal of me coming here today, for me personally, it's give you the MV to read the report and look into it and get interested in these matters. And that's what I maybe want to tease you a bit of what's in there and what you can find. So I'm going to maybe give you quickly some highlights, and with Natalie we could go into it deeper if Nicole, when I said Natalie? Why am I calling you Natalie? I don't know, Nicole. Okay. Unfortunately for the city of Montreal, it was a very fertile ground for us to study. A lot of stories that were going on in the media concerned the city of Montreal, so it was a natural starting point for us to start digging. So we, and then, the, like I said, the more we dug, the more we found stories, the more we found ideas and examples of schemes that were interesting for the commissioners to be able maybe to draw some recommendations on. So it had occupied a lot of our time, and on over the 4 years, we spent, I would say, a good 6 months just studying the city of Montreal and what was going on there. Just to give you an idea, what we found on the collusion side, four cartels of different companies were sharing the better part of all the contracts awarded for the city for almost more than a decade. They were using different techniques that are not new. I mean, nobody invented the wheel in the bid rigging department. I mean, they were using them all to make sure that they got the contract in turn. And David addressed it. One of the factors that made it easier for them is the fact that it's so predictable. When you go with the lowest bid all the time, every time, it gets so predictable for the market. And when companies decided to get together and arrange it, I mean, it's not hard for them to choose who's going to be the winner. I mean, they're all preparing the bids for each other. They know what are they going to bid. They're setting the bar, and everybody has to go higher than that. So it's a very predictable way of acquiring contracts when you collude together. Just to give you an example, in 2005, they had succeeded to reduce external competition by closing the market to almost nothing, and a handful of companies were sharing 95% of the contract that the city was awarding. And we found that over time, and it's over time that you can find that, over time, because they were colluding and they were predicting and they were setting the prices over time, they were able to raise the prices at least 30% from the market value, and they were able to, trick the market into thinking that it was the right price. Because when you evaluate the value of your contract because you want to put a tender out, you look at the prices, you look at the other contracts, and over time they were even pushing the evaluation of the right value of the contract. So they, at the end of the, by the beginning of 2010, the city of Montreal was paying over 30% more than it should pay. And a good proof of that, it's like from the day that we opened the camera at the inquiry, the prices began to drop. So, I mean, I think it's, I don't know if it's proof in a court of law, but could at least raise questions. Collusion is very hard to detect. It's a secretive crime, I would say that. They're colluding, they're not publicizing it, they're not saying, hey, look at us, we're getting into a cartel and we want to share the market. They're not saying that. So it's very hard to detect by looking at only one specific contract, only one specific event, or only one specific tender. It takes a close monitoring of the market. And if there's only one thing you take away from today, it's that. You have to monitor the market closely for a long period of time and never stop doing it. And it's the only way to you can detect the patterns, the flags, the anomalies, I would say, that could reflect the possibility of collusion. And of course, unless you have insider information or whistleblowers, and we can talk about it later, but that's very important. Whistleblowers are very important, but they're hard to come by, and then there's no real law protecting them, so you cannot only count on that to crack, if I could say, the schemes. But you have, and over time, this is the biggest, the best way to, it's you have to get data and collect data and analyze it and compare the contracts with one another and look at who's getting all the contracts, who's always bidding on the contracts. Is the competition shrinking or not? Is it striving? Do you have a lot of external companies coming on, new companies getting new contracts? And the biggest indicator is when you find out that in a particular field, the market is closed. Like I said, a handful of companies in Montreal for 15 years were getting 95% of the contract. That's not, I wouldn't say it's normal. And no external companies, no new bidders, they were always the same company bidding. The only difference is who was getting the contract. And when you were looking at the pattern over time, you could see the turns coming. You could see the wheels going on. You could almost predict who's the next company who's going to have the contract, but you had to have a lot of data to do that. And looking in one or two contracts or 1 or 2 years, you can't do that sort of thing. So, and then that's what you can have to start to worry and maybe push the investigation a little further. About corruption, I mean, there's many ways to corruption. There's all type of corruption. We encountered all types of corruption, all types of examples from the smallest to the biggest. But what I wanted to draw attention to this morning is what we called political corruption in regards to political financing and the problems it can create. We found it in all level of governments, municipal, provincial, and though it was declined in different ways. What we think, and Quebec has been thinking it for 30 years because it's been 30 years that the companies and unions and lobbying groups and pressure groups don't have the right to finance. Only individuals have the right to finance, but like David said, they work their way around that. Because we think and we still think that political financing creates a big vulnerability for our elective, and it's a way for the private sector to acquire influence and leverage. In an ideal world, you should move away from private foundings, but I mean, it's not possible to do entirely. In Quebec, we even raised the bar on public financing. We had a pro rata that you could buy number of votes that you get a certain amount of money. We raised the bar since the commission because you can, but it's hard to entirely eliminate all sorts of public private funding for this type of situation. But like I said, in an ideal world, we should ban that because to make sure that we shield our politicians from this kind of undue influence in order to avoid any type of conflicts of interest or appearance of conflicts of interest, even if it's not there. That's the way to chip at the public trust. If you think that the politician awards a contract who pushes towards a awarding of a contract to a company because this company is financing him, even if in fact all the rules were followed, I mean, there's a breach in the trust, and then from there it's like a spiraling down. We've been there, believe me. And you avoid any kind of payback or pressure to have this payback done. So, and our work for 4 years revealed that it was a legitimate concern of ours. So that is something else. If you take away from today, it's something that you should be concerned about. And we really think it's important to address the situation. So now if you, Nicole. I can.
Thank you, Sonia. Now we'll just sit down and have a bit of a discussion where I ask some questions.
Yeah. And we did not practice, so.
Okay, there we go. So Before we get into policy discussions, is there a story for you that illustrates how the Commission of Inquiry grew beyond anyone's expectations?
But like I said, I don't have a specific story, but nobody expected that the length of what we would find, or how deep the story were going, and how deep this system was in play. It was not stories, it was a system, and that is what we didn't expect to find. We expected to find stories, we expected to find allegations and stuff right in there, but we found a system, and that's what threw us off a bit, I would say.
Could you describe that system a bit more, sort of which industries in particular you found the system was completely rigged?
Well, this, for example, in the political financing, what we found by examining all the donations over time, we found that companies were always giving more to the party in power, but always giving to both parties. So don't tell me it's for political reasons or for because you believe in them, because I mean, the same engineering firm or construction companies were always giving to both parties, but always a little bit more to the party in power. And we had the third party in 2005, where it looked like it would come ahead and maybe have a chance of being elected or grab the power, and it was a peak in the donation. So this is what, and we did, like, we examined it for 15 years, and it was going on for 15 years. So, and nobody will convince me that a business is not giving money for business reasons. So if you are convinced of that, I mean, I don't know what your arguments are.
There also in the report, there were many industries that seemed particular, especially in the public procurement section of the report, such as the paving industry.
Yep.
And can you speak to a few of the industries?
I'm not saying, but I can't say it's because it only happens there, but our mandate was to examine these situations, so it's a little bit, yeah, it's not fair to pretend that it's in this industry is more rotten, corrupted than other. But I think all public procurement system, every time you have public money, you have to look into it. But I would say yes, in pavement and road constructions, it was like bad. But that was our mandate to look into that. So I mean, but we had allegations that we didn't inquire because we couldn't, about l'informatique, computers. Le déneigement for the snow removal. So every time you have money or big budget for public contracts, I mean, look into that.
That's one piece of information from the international system, which is interesting, is that the OECD, the Organization for Economic Development and Cooperation, finds that I think over 50% of corruption happens when there are large in public procurement, because the contracts are so large, and so that's one of the places to look when you're trying to detect corruption.
That's where the money is. So.
Right.
Follow the money.
Follow the money. What are some of the top policy lessons you drew from the research and evidence before the commission that you would recommend that any province consider implementing to avoid collusion or corruption? You have 60 recommendations, so there are a lot in there. And I'm wondering, are they all transferable? Are there any recommendations that were specific to Quebec that we, you know, might not be as relevant in other places?
Well, I don't know specifically about British Columbia's laws or the way you're working with your public procurement system, whatever. But if they're not transferable in details, they are in essence. Because like I said, and I'm going to repeat myself, you have to monitor stuff. So the number one recommendation of the commission was to create an autorité des marchés publics, a public authority market, public market authority, something like that. Well, they can change the name all they want as long as they keep the essence of what we meant. What we meant is like an authority that could closely monitor the market and help the the ministries are les donneurs d'ouvrage, the ones that are giving public contracts, the organizations that are, have public money to give and to award into contracts, help them with their procurement process, help them with the monitoring of the companies, the monitoring of the market. So and you have to centralize the information. The problem we had is like, we were, for 4 years, we were basically the, well, we were not created for a long time. We had a limited time amended, like all public inquiries. So we thought about recommending a permanent commission of inquiry, if I might say so. But it's the same thing because for 4 years we were centralizing the information. We were gathering the information at all levels, municipal, provincial, every type of cities, and it's by central. And then you could see all the companies, the same companies in other cities and getting the market. And then you could see that they were not only sharing the contracts on one city, but sometimes they were sharing the territory geographically. And if you don't centralize information, let's say I'm the city of Montreal, I'm looking only at my stuff and I'm not looking at what Quebec is doing, or even all over Canada, or the city next door is doing, I don't realize that my companies don't go in Laval, and why? It's just across the river. They can bid there, they have all the tools to do it. It's like a bridge away, so why are they not bidding on the other side of the river? So if you don't centralize the information and you don't closely monitor the market, you don't realize that. And if I, like I said, this is the main thing, and every recommendation then falls from that knowledge, and you have to adapt them to your own reality. But of course, the, like I said, the rationale behind it, them certainly are exportable.
Were there any mistakes that you encountered, or that a jurisdiction should try to avoid, to minimize corruption and collusion? Were there any particular lessons that you learned?
The first mistake is to think that you don't have it, that's for sure. And then too many rules also. I mean, if you paralyze the market, you can't do that. And one of the mistakes that we found, I wouldn't say it a mistake, but a lack of understanding of the consequences, I would say. It's like you have to create an environment that where la concurrence, how can you say concurrence? Competition is thriving and always there, and when you have too many rules, you have to protect your own companies, I understand that, but if you close yourself, you close a market, and you avoid external companies to come and competition to thrive and help them, I mean, you create that sort of environment for collusion in a way. So, but it's not a mistake per se. I mean, no, I wouldn't say we found mistakes, because We had all the laws, like I said, in public political funding. We have a lot of rules and regulations, but they found a way around it. But you have to look into that always.
One of the interesting things I found when I was reading the public procurement section of the report was that there were some sort of counterintuitive recommendations. For example, you would think that transparency would be just uniformly a good thing in the public procurement process, because people would then know how the decisions were made, who was making the decisions, who was bidding on the contracts. Can you talk a little bit about those findings, which I think are not obvious?
Okay, transparency, yes, but not necessarily in real time and not necessarily to anybody or everybody at the same time. What we mean, we found that for example, if I know as a contractor who went to get the information to bid, I now know who to talk to collude and arrange a market, or I know who to pressure to exclude. And that's the way they were doing it. They knew how new companies were bidding, because you say, how do they close the market? Because they knew about it. They knew about it in advance, and they were intimidating or persuading companies to withdraw their bid from there, or to get in line with them and participate. So sometimes we found that that information, yes, but information, if we have it, they have it. So you have to find a balance between transparency and protecting your awarding process.
And it was the same for the people on the selection committee as well,
yes,
right?
Was.
So it was on both sides. If
yes.
you knew who the members of the selection committee were,
yeah.
then you could also go and influence them.
Because what we found that they didn't know who would be on a selection committee at a specific for a specific contract, but they knew the list of people who could be chose for. So it's the same. I mean, and then those are some examples of corruptions that we found, because if we knew of who could be on a contract at one point in time that is not awarded by the lowest bidder, but the quality evaluation, because it happens in the engineering firm for us in Quebec. It's not the lowest bid, but you have to ponderate with quality, and so you have a selection committee for that. So you can influence them, and sometimes it's by offering a job. It's not even money. It's by offering a job in your big firm that they wish they had. So corruption doesn't always come in the brown envelope, I would say. that we learned that too.
Can you talk about some of the red flags for identifying corruption or collusion? When you were doing this work, what would you look for when you were trying to identify the potential problems?
I mean, the red flags are the same all over the world. And when you look at big rigging, you look at the bid that were done. If they are not that far apart, they're very regular in the amount. I'm sure I'm not expressing myself well here. Let's say the contract goes out for $10,000, and then you see that the second highest one is $12,000, and the third highest is $14,000, and then it's $16,000. They're not very imaginative. When they get into this for 15 years, at the beginning, I mean, every item, they do their work, and they almost do real bids, you know, to set a very nice smoke screen. But like I said, when you closely monitor the system, and then over 4, 5, 6 years, I mean, they're tired of it. I mean, even, and sometimes they say, okay, now you're gonna get that contract, prepare all the bids. So I mean, they're not very imaginative. So you see regularity in the bid amount and the difference. Sometimes you see items that they have all the same price for one particular item of the contract, and say it's impossible. I mean, that he lives like 200 miles away and it's just right next door, that it can't cost the same thing. So, but you have to analyze it. So those are red flags. It doesn't mean anything by itself, but when you look at it, you at least you can dig deeper.
When you looked into the links between the political party financing and the awarding of public contracts, could you talk about some of the differences between the municipalities and the provinces?
Okay, in Quebec, the mayors in the have more influence in the awarding of contracts. The rules are not quite the same. It's less rigid. So if a mayor wants to award a contract to a particular business, it's easier for him to decide who's going to get it or to. And sometimes what we saw in municipal work is like the financing, the political financing was directly linked with, we could follow the money and point out the contract that was awarded at the end of the line. It was easier to say, okay, they gave that amount of money and they got that share of the business, or they got that contract in particular. And it was easier to boucler la boucle, to go around in a closed circle to the contract. In the provincial world, it's not the same. We found that companies were giving over time and for a long period of time, and sometimes you say, well, you cannot see or find any particular or direct link to a contract, because that was our mandate, to look at the links between the awarding process of a contract and financial, political financing. So it was harder on the professional stage. But what we found is like the money for us, you cannot lobby if you're not a official lobby group in Quebec. Companies usually are not registered as lobby group, and for them it was a way of lobbying, a way to approach politicians, a way to have influence. And sometimes it's not a particular contract, but maybe a budget that would be, okay, let's say, well, we have a problem with our roads, so we could invest anywhere. And let's say I'm working in, I do pavement. I'm a pavement company, and I have a group of pavements company. Maybe I will be more interested that our politician investing in repairing the existing road than doing new roads, because my field is paving. So I'm going to influence that the budget goes, the budget of this year or the next year, or the next 5 years goes towards my way. And then I'm going to collude with my gang, so I make sure that I get my share of the contract. It's more like a lot of companies said for us, financing politicians was kind of an entrance. Okay, so they were more financing to make sure that they would keep getting business than to get a specific contract. So it was more subtle, I would say, the link there. Less obvious, at least.
Okay, on a completely different track, can you talk about some of the impacts of this work on you personally?
Well, I'm here. I'm here. Well, I don't want to get into sappy stories or anything, but it was a hard work. And the hardest thing for us was to adapt to this instant, I would say, stardom, but because it would, for 4 years it became a reality show in Quebec. And you still want to be taken seriously because you were doing serious work. And it was not a show, but because of the stories that we uncovered, it became a show. And for me, what I'm trying to do now is to steer the report away from that impression. And maybe that's what's sad, because in Quebec, we did all that painful work, we exposed ourselves, and now it's like, I feel personally that government, and we want to forget about it and not bury it in the sense that we want to politically bury it, but we don't want to hear about it anymore because we were so into that for 4 years. Now we just want to get rid of this thing, you know. So for me, it's to keep the report alive, and I'm very happy that I have this opportunities to keep it alive and talk about it and say, okay, that was painful, but still something came out of that, and we should be the first to use them. We did, but not enough to my satisfaction. So if it could put pressure on Quebec, the fact that British Columbia is interested, that's my agenda, you know.
Yeah. Can you talk a bit more about whistleblowers? I was in a conversation with the head of the United States government's Whistleblower Protection Agency, who told me that whistleblowers, even though there are great whistleblower protection laws, often end up in a very difficult situation after they blow the whistle, because they lose their jobs, they're ostracized, they really have a difficult time. So can you talk a bit more about your findings on whistleblowing and what your recommendations would be?
Yes, there's two things to be able to detect these types of situations. I said it in my remarks. It's closely monitoring the market and whistleblowers. Those are the key to fighting corruption, fighting collusions, because those are silent crimes. I mean, if you're talking about it, if you know about it, it's because usually you're involved in it. So it's hard to talk about it, and if you talk about it, you implicate yourself. So whistleblowers are very hard to come about, but they know what's going on from inside. They understand, they were privy to the conversations, to the collusions and stuff. So, and we don't protect them enough. And even at the commission, we found out that we had the public inquiry law in Quebec gives immunity from civil and criminal prosecution from your testimony in front of the commission. But there were still consequences. We had engineer testifying, and they were banned from their profession.
Professional
bar. They had problem with them because they didn't have immunity from that. We had the contractors testifying. They lost their companies. They lost their. Nobody wanted to do business with them anymore. We understand why. And then, more and more, we were going into the audiences and the testimonies, the less and the harder it became for us to get witnesses, because even if our public inquiry law gave immunity to some aspects, there are a lot of consequences that we don't think about and that we have to think about. I don't know if a law can encourage somebody to come forward, but at least if somebody is willing to do it, we should take them, help them, and not prize and not value what they did, but value the fact that they are helping us. And they are coming forward, and their reputation is going to be tarnished anyway. So we have to help them and work them through that and accompany them the best that we can.
So we see anti-corruption units in Quebec and in New York and in many other jurisdictions. Do you think that all jurisdictions should have an anti-corruption investigative body? Or do you think it's sufficient to leave it with local police and RCMP in certain situations?
It's not sufficient to leave it with local police, because another thing that we found, you cannot attack systems. You can attack individuals, but not systems by only prosecuting them. That is not, you're not going to attack the system. You might remove someone, but somebody else is going to take its place if the system is still there. So prevention, detection, prosecutions are all tools that you have to work with. And a unit like UPAC that in Quebec or New York or l'Autorité des marchés publics, the public market authority that we are putting forward, could do all that at the same time. It all starts with education. You have to inform people, you have to educate them on the red flags, you have to give them the tools to detect, the tools to cope with it if a situation arises. Because if you're a public servant and you offered money, what do you do with it? Do you go to your boss? I mean, what is he going to think? If they offered me that, it's just because I was open for it, and maybe it's, and sometimes it starts with a small favor that you do for a friend and you don't realize that it's not your money, it's public money. But so it's all a gray area, and we didn't find big criminals and big corruption. It's all small things, and it becomes a system, and you don't know how to get out of it. And so it's a good idea to have those units, because the police in itself cannot attack systems. It can attack individuals.
Another aspect of that education, I think, would be to sort of address this notion I hear often, that corruption is a victimless crime, that it doesn't actually impact individuals.
Victims.
Yeah, so I think that's. Did you come across that sort of perception as well, that the white collar crime isn't so bad because it's not really, there aren't really victims for
but
that?
People have the notion that public interest is no interest at all. It's not right. I mean, it's our interest, it's our personal interest as an individual. And it, like I said, I was paying as a citizen 30% more than I should pay for my roads, and believe me, in Quebec, they're bad. So I don't know what I was giving money for. So my taxes go up. I don't have enough. I don't have as much service as I want to have in other areas. So it's not a victimless crime. It's like we're all victims. And that's a notion that we have to move away from. Public interest is our interest.
I'll have one last question, and then I think we have to wrap up because we have to give over the room to another group. But because we're in a law school, many in the audience are likely to be lawyers or law students. Do you have any specific advice for lawyers, based on your work, about the role the legal profession can play in either preventing collusion or corruption, or, on the other hand, furthering it? I mean, because they can work both ways, right?
Well, we have... I don't know if I really have advice because I came about doing this work I would say by chance or by mistake, I don't know. But I always worked in the public interest domain as a Crown prosecutor. I'm not the lawyers of victims, I'm the lawyer of the society. And I think that whatever you choose to do, if you keep that in mind as a professional, that even if you have a client, even if you have to work for your client, you should always try to work for higher purpose. I say, and we're well positioned for that because we know the laws, we know the rules, we know how to analyze situations. But I think if you have that in mind, then you're going to have a nice career. But if you choose to work for the government, to work for the public interest, this is very, you could do great work, I think. I'm biased because I've always done that, so.
There's also, you may have seen, there was a Global Witness interviews of lawyers, I think, for large, in throughout New York City, that had the person who was going to different law firms and asking on behalf of a sort of sketchy foreign, you know, seemingly a dictator, you know, how the law firm could help them or the lawyers could help them. So can you talk, was there that side as well of, that you would see about lawyers sort of facilitating some of the corrupt activities?
Yes, we saw that, but we didn't get into that because it was not related to the construction industry, but we saw that lawyers that were financing parties to get the contentieux, the business that they could get from the cities or from the province. So we saw that in lawyers too. I mean, for real. And if you have to be aware of that also. So.
Okay. Thanks very much. Oh, I think we'll end it there, and maybe I'll turn it over to David to say a few closing remarks.
Please join me in thanking Nicole and Sonia for a wonderful discussion and presentation here at Saturday.